So 3 John, beginning at verse 1, the elder to the beloved Gaius, whom I love in truth. Beloved, I pray that you may prosper in all things and be in health, just as your soul prospers, for I rejoiced greatly when brethren came and testified of the truth that is in you. Just as you walk in the truth, I have no greater joy than to hear that my children walk in truth. Beloved, you do faithfully whatever you do for the brethren and for strangers who have borne witness of your love before the church. If you send them forward on their journey in a manner worthy of God, you will do well, because they went forth for his name's sake, taking nothing from the Gentiles. We therefore ought to receive such, that we may become fellow workers for the truth. I wrote to the church, but Diotrephes, who loves to have the preeminence among them, does not receive us. Therefore, if I come, I will call to mind his deeds which he does, prating against us with malicious words, and not content with that, he himself does not receive the brethren and forbids those who wish to, putting them out of the church. Beloved, do not imitate what is evil, but what is good. He who does good is of God, but he who does evil has not seen God. Demetrius has a good testimony from all, and from the truth itself. We also bear witness, and you know that our testimony is true. I had many things to write, but I do not wish to write to you with pen and ink. But I hope to see you shortly, and we shall speak face to face. Peace to you. Our friends greet you. Greet the friends by name. 3 John. Let's look at this. Let me give you a little background, just so that for those of you who take notes and like to get that kind of information, you might have that information so that you can look at it in its context. 3 John is a letter that centers on three people in a particular church. We saw them as we were going through this. Gaius, Diotrephes, and Demetrius. Now, Gaius and Demetrius are mentioned in a positive light, but Diotrephes, we really don't know how, I don't know how to pronounce his name, we can call him Joe if you'd like, is looked at in the negative. There are parallels between 2 and 3 John, and that gives us reason to believe that the date is around the same for both of those letters. It was written around 90 A.D. There is a purpose in this letter, and that is to encourage a man named Gaius to continue his Christian service to those in need. And it's also intended to expose the prideful power hunger of a pastor named Diotrephes. Now, to get this context down, Gaius had welcomed missionaries into his home. He cared for their various needs. He cared for them in the sense of giving them meals and lodging, finances, other necessities. And in doing so, what he was actually doing was simply acting as a Christian. You know, the Bible tells us in Galatians, for example, chapter 6, verse 10, that as we have opportunity, let us do good to all people, especially to those who belong to the family of believers. And so we're commanded to do good. We're to be good and do good in general, but we especially are called by God to care for those who are in the family of faith. In Hebrews 13, 1 and 2, it says, keep on loving each other as brothers. Do not forget to entertain strangers, for by doing, some have entertained angels without knowing it. And so there is a spiritual element to this kind of generosity and hospitality. So on the one hand, Gaius had welcomed missionaries into his home, yet on the other hand, the pastor, Diotrephes, was opposed to this. He didn't like him performing this kind of ministry. And the reason for that is given in verse 9 when it simply says that he loves to have preeminence. So he was a bully is what he was. He had what is called selfish ambition. He had a longing for power. And his selfish ambition and his longing for control and power actually motivated his response. Now the Bible tells us in Philippians chapter 2 verse 3, let nothing be done through selfish ambition or conceit, but in lowliness of mind, let each esteem others better than himself. And Diotrephes should have known that better than the average person in the body of Christ. And yet, for some reason, he seemed to forget that lesson. You see, if false teachers had entered in, the Bible tells us that Diotrephes would have been required to deal with them. That was established throughout John's first and second letters. False teachers could infiltrate. False teachers, from the very beginning, have entered in to the body of Christ with the attempt to undermine the direction that God would have the church to go and to undermine the faith of individuals. We live in a time, a day today, that many people do not understand that there is something that is really called truth, and that the church has been given the chore to, the job, the ministry of safeguarding. The Bible refers to us in 1 Timothy chapter 3 as the church is the pillar and the ground of the truth. And so in the early days of the church, there were those who would creep in, and as they crept in to the church, there were sheep that would succumb to their bad doctrine. And because they were yielding to the things that were being said, the pastor had been given the authority to wield that rod of authority in order to protect the sheep from the error that they might embrace. So Diotrephes was, for false teachers, called by God to make sure that they didn't have a place in the church. In 2 John, I'll give you an example, verses 10 and 11, it says there, if anyone comes to you and does not bring this doctrine, do not receive him into your house nor greet him, for he who greets him shares in his evil deeds. And so false teachers were not to be encouraged in any way. False teachers were not to be supported in any way by the church. They were actually supposed to reject. The church was to reject the false doctrine. Now, I didn't prepare a lot of statements that are running through my mind right now as it relates to that, but I can say to you this, that because of the state of the church in the United States today, there are quite a number of people who support false ministries. And whenever I name the false ministries, or whenever I've warned in the past, be careful about this, there are those who are young in their faith, perhaps weak in their faith, or perhaps have not matured in their faith. There's whatever reason there may be, and they get upset at me, and I get the letters and the angry, you know, standing up, walking out, and demonstrating how spiritual they are by walking out while I'm speaking and all of that. But the bottom line is there some churches out there that I, as a pastor, have the responsibility not to judge the man's heart, but to say this is what's being said, therefore be careful because it's not lining up with Scripture. I've had conversations over the years many times related to this, and and I just had a conversation going on my Facebook page, which, you know, the Facebook for me is a good ministry opportunity. I enjoy the dialogue and the letters that I get and the questions that will come through it and all of that. And yet at the same time, because I've got like 5,000 people that are called friends, it's not all of them go to this fellowship, and so they go to other fellowships, and so they'll bring in their whatever, their point of view, and that happens. And if I write something, there are times when someone will message me and say, well, how about this? Or they want to post their ideas and all of that. And that's a forum where, I don't have a real problem with that, as long as we don't go in the wrong direction. And recently, I was mentioning one particular teacher, I won't mention by name, Joel Osteen. And there was an open letter written to him. And he's a winsome young man. He's got a beautiful wife. They've got, great personalities and all. And I said, I posted a letter that was written, with an encouraging, loving warning to them to get into the Word of God and teach God's Word. That's what pastors are supposed to do, by the way. And the Bible says in the latter days, some will depart from the faith, giving heed to seducing spirits and the doctrines of demons. And the reason they do that is, Paul said, having itching ears. Having itching ears, what does that mean? That they're always scratching their ears? No, they're looking for somebody who will tickle their ears. They're looking for somebody who will say the things they want to hear. And that's not hard to do. because there are plenty of people out there communicating things that you would love to hear. And that's why sometimes churches can explode in numbers, because that man is saying things that these people want to hear. So who doesn't want to hear that today is your best day? Who doesn't want to hear that you are the head, not the tail? You know, that's just something that because here we go. I wasn't preparing this. I didn't prepare this, but here, travel with me for a minute. Because it sounds like I'm condemning people, and that's why I have a problem. That's why I keep stopping myself. Because I'm not. I'm not condemning, but I am observing and commenting, and that's my responsibility. Bottom line is because we are in an era of self-love. Now, Paul said in 2 Timothy 3, he said that in the latter days, there'll be two things. Well, he actually lists several things. First couple things, he speaks about men being lovers of themselves, you know, and that's what we call narcissism. That's the self-love, the self-absorption. So everything has to meet my criteria. You know, it's kind of like when I go to a certain burger place, you know, I'm going to have it my way. And that's how people are. And it's in the church. It's in the body of Christ. I still remember in this auditorium, after a Sunday morning, a woman approaching me and saying to me, "This is my first day here, and I just wanted to ask you, what does this church have to offer me?" You know, that's a legitimate question. But I said, the question isn't, what does this church have to offer you? The question is, what do you have to offer this church? Because we're taught here to serve the Lord. And so what this church has to offer is an encouragement to be a servant to Jesus Christ, because there's no greater thing that you can do than to serve the Lord, right? I would hope that we'd agree on that. There's nothing greater than serving Jesus Christ. I mean, if you don't want to serve the Lord, then you probably don't want to go to heaven either. I mean, that's just the way it is, right? I mean, that's what the Scriptures teach us. That's what we are. But see, because we don't think that way, we have a tendency of heaping unto ourselves teachers, because we have itching ears. We're turned aside from the truth. We're turned unto fables. And that is a sign of the last days. And so I'm not impressed by auditoriums filled with people. What I'm impressed with is men and women who love Jesus Christ and serve Him completely and do works for Him. So the size of the church, do you think that Jesus is saying, "I'm sorry, there's only 100 people there. That's just a real waste of my time. You know, I want to go over to Houston where there's 48,000. If Jesus walks into the room, as I see it when I read Scripture, and of course He liked multitudes and He liked individuals, and we can develop that too. But when He'd walk into a synagogue, the first thing He did is He ministered to a demon-possessed man, or He'd minister to a person with a withered hand, or he was drawn to the need. And so in ministry, what we're supposed to do is we're supposed to discover the heart of God and do that. And the pastor has a responsibility of encouraging people to follow the right path. Now, we have authority, we have to exercise it, and if a false teacher were to walk in, a man like Diotrephes, who was put in the position of leadership, had a responsibility to check out on whether or not their doctrine was proper or not, and if it wasn't proper, they were not to welcome them into their house. Now, when it speaks about someone who comes to you and doesn't bring this doctrine, don't receive them into your house nor greet them, we need to remember that the early church met in houses. And what they were saying was not like 21st century. I've had people say, "Well, if a Jehovah's Witness knocks on my door, should I keep them in the front porch? You know, don't let them into my house, because doesn't it say that?" And I've had to explain, that's how you can dialogue with them, invite them in, give them a glass of water, share the love of Jesus with them. That's what we do. So the house that he was speaking about is this. If somebody were to come here to this church and would say, "I'm from such and so church, and I have a message to bring," if their doctrine doesn't line up with Scripture, I'm not to welcome them in, give them a place of prominence, or allow them to teach their doctrine. because in doing so, I'm actually blessing them as they're doing things that are contrary to what Scripture has to say. And that's why you won't see, for example, you know, anybody who is not doctrinally solid teaching from this pulpit, teaching the Word of God from this pulpit. There will be times, perhaps in the future, we've had it once in the past, where I might invite somebody who has a differing view, and I'll put them against somebody who espouses doctrinally what we accept, and they can debate the issues in front of the church. But that person with a differing view is not being placed in a pulpit to preach his message to you as if it's truth. That person is being given an opportunity for you to hear their side and then get the rebuts that come from the individuals who represent Orthodox Christianity. But when I bring in to this pulpit somebody who doesn't teach the Word of God, no. Would I bring somebody into this pulpit, somebody who's going to teach you that Jesus is Michael the Archangel? No. Why not? You're unloving, Pastor David. That's the whole problem I have with you. You're a judge. Well, Jesus said that I am to judge righteous judgment. And one of the gifts of the Spirit is the gift of discerning of spirits. And we are called by the Word of God to become discerning or judging. The word discernment speaks of judgment, so that we can hear and we can balance and test whether these things are true and embrace what is true and reject that which is false. And so the whole purpose of Bible studies in times like this is for us to be built up in our faith so that we may know the ways of God, so that we're equipped for works of service, so that we can share with others the truth of Jesus Christ. Diotrephes, as a pastor, has a responsibility of doing that. But he doesn't have the responsibility of telling his church not to minister to sincere believers in Christ. And that's what's taking place in this particular situation. Gaius was acting responsibly in helping the missionaries because they were the genuine article. But on the other hand, Diotrephes was in the wrong because his motives were impure, because he did those things because he wanted to have preeminence. So he wasn't acting as a shepherd. He was acting as a bully. Now, with that in mind, John chose to use certain words repeatedly. You notice when I was reading it, he used the word beloved and the word love 7 times in 14 verses. He used the word truth and the word true 7 times. Love and truth. Love and truth go together, don't they? Love and truth. I'm 20 years old. You're looking at me saying, no, you're not. I was born on leap year. I'm 20 years old. I'm barefooted. I've been drinking, smoking pot. My eyes are glazed. My hair is not really combed nicely. Wearing a raggedy t-shirt and jeans. And I walk into church for the first time. A church called Calvary Chapel. And nobody looked at me and said, you don't belong here. Look at the way you're dressed. Put on some shoes. Get your hair cut. Brothers and sisters, in 1970, that was common in the church. You're a lot of youngsters here, you wouldn't know that. But you would not have walked into a church without shoes. Any church. You just didn't do that. You see, this was a different place. This is a place filled with the love of God. New carpet had been put down on the floors. And because hippies didn't like to wear shoes. The elders, ushers, had noticed that these hippies were walking in barefooted. Well, anybody here knows that when you walk around barefooted, the oils on your feet get rubbed into the carpet, dirty up that carpet. They had just laid some new carpet. So they put a sign, and the sign said, "No shoes, no entrance." They're trying to be good stewards. They're trying to take care of the place God gave to them. They did it with a good heart. Pastor Chuck providentially arrives early. And he sees that sign. And he picks it up. And he starts hitting him with this. My father's, no, that was Jesus. And it's a house of prayer. He made it a den of thieves and he drove him out. I'm sorry. No, he just took the sign and he trashed it. And he got the guys and he said, "If new carpets keep one kid from coming in to find Jesus Christ, let's rip up the carpets so they could come in." Now that's my heritage. That's my heritage. And what is that? What would that be called now? That would be called love. And that's why I was talking to the men today in the meeting. And I said the same thing to them. 20-year-old kid, loaded, drinking, walks into a place, ambushed by something I had never felt in a church. In a church. Ambushed by love. God help us. God help us not to become old wineskins. God help us to not look at that kid with the earrings and say, "Oh, the kid with the tattoos up and down their arms, how can you, don't you know?" You know what? That kid with the tats, maybe you don't want them, and maybe you don't like them, and I'm fine with that. But I don't think that Jesus cares about those tattoos. I think Jesus cares about that kid. I believe that Jesus cares about that kid. And we gotta be careful. We gotta be careful. I have staff members who are tatted all over the place. How can you have somebody like that on staff? Because they love the Lord Jesus Christ. That's why. Well, what other person would I have on? Clean skin, dirty heart? You know, I'm telling you that. Be careful. Be careful, because we can stop loving. I was not booted out of that place. I wasn't kicked out of that place. I was welcomed. Why? Because I needed the Lord Jesus Christ. And that's what I've always wanted for us as a group of people. And so, beloved, or the word love, 7 times, because love is so important and so is truth. And so that's your introduction. We better get into the book, right? Verse 1, "The elder to the beloved Gaius, whom I love in truth." He begins with a very simple introduction. He is the last surviving apostle of the original 12. He is what would be called the leading elder in the body of Christ. He is an elder. He is not only positionally, an elder in the sense of in the hierarchy of the church, how the church is run, and it's run by elders, but he is also an older man. An older man. One brief thing, is that in a youth-oriented society, and church is becoming more youth-oriented also, and I understand a lot about that in terms of like the attractiveness of youth and the abilities of youth to understand the needs of other youth and all, and I think that's all very valid. We still need to respect elders in the body of Christ, don't we? You know, you can go to the doctor and the doctor has 40 years experience in the particular illness you have, or you could go to the doctor who's got a year's experience in the particular illness that you have, and maybe you're the sort who is pretty much an equal opportunity person. You'll say, "Oh, well, that 1 year, you know, new guy is good with me." You know me, I prefer the guy who's been there 40 years just because he's got a lot of experience, because I'm kind of picky when it comes to my health. You know, if I went to somebody and said, "You know, I need to have an operation," the guy says, "Gee whiz, that's great. I just graduated." I'd say, "Well, that's neat. Do you have anybody else you might suggest, you know?" I like experience, and experience in the body of Christ is very important. And so we need to respond that way, because in a time when the young people are casting out the old and not wanting them, the last pastor's conference, one of the young pastors were saying something about the dinosaurs who were teaching at the pastor's conference. From my perspective, that's just youth speaking, because we need elders and we need men and older women who have walked that road for a long time to help us along the way. And so he's an elder, and he's writing to guys whom he loves in the truth. And this is obviously a personal letter to a member of the church that is pastored by Diotrephes. But when he says, whom I love in truth, that's a simple affirmation. He's simply saying, whom I love sincerely. Now, here's something for you, applicationally. Whom I love sincerely. Religious people are especially adept at pretending they love people. Am I right in that? Yeah, I am. Amen, Pastor David. That's true. But they are. Religious people are especially adept at putting on that, oh, I love you face. I've been places where they'll say, give one another the sign of peace in a church service. Oh, God be with you, my brother. And they won't speak to you in the parking lot. But there they are, hugging one another and greeting one another, giving each other the sign of peace and this and that. They can't stand each other. I've seen that. So have you. We're really adept. We're really good at hypocrisy. Putting on the mask. Oh, I love you. I love you so much, I'm going to tell you the truth. And then we rip them up and down in love, right? Because we are very good at that. You know, loving people is what we're supposed to do, right? Here's an example for you. In the Gospels, in more than one Gospel, we have a woman by the name of Mary. She was Lazarus' sister. And Mary wanted to express her love for the Lord Jesus Christ. And so what does Mary do? Well, she anoints his head and she anoints his feet with a very, very expensive perfume. As a matter of fact, the Bible tells us that this particular ointment, this spikenard that she used, was worth 300 days' wages. That is obviously very expensive. That's a year's wages, is what that's saying. And so when this takes place, it's found in John 12, 4 through 6. One of his disciples, Judas Iscariot, Simon's son, who would betray him, said, "Why was this fragrant oil not sold for 300 denarii and given to the poor?" And John goes on to say, "This he said, not that he cared for the poor, but because he was a thief and had the money box and used to take what was put in it." And what he did is he used love as a cover-up. This could have been sold and the poor could have been cared for. And I'm telling you, a lot of times when people want to give you what we used to call, I don't know if they still use this word, I think they do, a zinger, when they want to kind of just give you a poke, they'll say something like, it's nice that you're nice to Marie, but are you still beating her? I mean, they twist things around. This should have been sold. You know, it's just another way of selling, sounding holy and loving, and we could have given it to the poor. See, religious people are very good at hypocrisy. But love in the Lord is to be genuine because, this is basic, because he genuinely loved us. And because he genuinely loved us, we're to love one another. Romans 12:9, let love be without hypocrisy. 1 Peter 1:22, since you have purified your souls in obeying the truth through the Spirit in sincere love of the brethren, love one another fervently with a pure heart. So John loved Gaius sincerely, and he let him know. Now, verse 2 is one of those verses that's been taken out of context many times. Beloved, I pray that you may prosper in all things and be in health just as your soul prospers. This is what is called a general blessing. It was a common greeting during that period. He's saying, may you prosper, may you have good health, and may you be spiritually mature. By the way, those are things that are proper to pray for in our desire to live a life that is blessed by God. There's nothing wrong with saying, Lord, I would pray that you would prosper my life in every way. I would pray that you would work within me in every way. May I grow in you, and may I find success in the things that I do in your name. In 1 Chronicles 4:10, it says, Jabez called on the God of Israel, saying, oh, that you would bless me indeed and enlarge my territory, that your hand would be with me, and that you would keep me from evil, that I may not cause pain. And God granted him that request. There's nothing wrong with saying, God, would you bless my life? But the reality is if you bless mine, Lord, it's so that I might be a blessing to somebody else. So God may bless you in every aspect of your life, physically, spiritually, materially, but this is not a guarantee of health and prosperity. What this is simply a blessing and a prayer for spiritual growth. He says in verse 3, I rejoiced greatly when brethren came and testified of the truth that is in you, just as you walk in the truth. I have no greater joy than to hear that my children walk in truth. So John rejoices in the knowledge that Gaius is maturing in his walk in the Lord. And by the way, this rejoicing to hear that his spiritual children are walking in the truth is something that causes every spiritual mentor, every pastor, great joy. It's something that we want. It's a blessing on the occasions that I will have somebody say, oh, I ran into somebody from your fellowship, and what a blessing they are to me. That causes my heart to rejoice. When the Katinas come in, and others like the Katinas, and they were here just last week, but I can tell you, they will say things like, you know, we love coming to your fellowship. Your church has got such sweet hearts, and they're such sweet people. That blesses my heart, because I know as a minister that the people are walking in the truth. I rejoice in that, and so that's something every pastor, every spiritual mentor rejoices in. He says in verse 3, the second portion, he said, when brethren came and testified of the truth that is in you, just as you walk in the truth. And his ministry has reached the ears of the aged apostles by those whom Gaius had ministered to, and that's what caused him to rejoice. Let's look at this in a practical way briefly. Know this, know that your personal ministry is very often spoken of and recognized by other people. Know that. And know this also. The things that people say concerning your personal ministry are very often the very small things. It's the small and simple things that you do that very often touches and blesses people's hearts. Never forget that. Sometimes you may feel that you're not really doing anything because you're not having this huge international impact. You may be thinking that you're nothing and doing nothing. That's absolutely not true. My mama was, because of physical disabilities, incapable of getting out of her bed her last year of her life. Mama had been bedridden off and on for many years. And she would talk to me, and she would say to me, with tears quite often, how difficult it was for her. And I always told her the same thing. I said, Mom, I said, there's one thing you can do in that bed that you do well, and that is you pray. You're a prayer warrior. And you take petitions to God. And you love the Lord. And don't let the enemy whisper into your ear that you're nothing and useless, because you're not. Because, Mama, you pray for my ministry. You pray for your children. You pray for your grandchildren. You pray for your great-grandchildren. You lift them to the Lord in prayer. Never let the enemy make you think that you are useless. Because that's what he wants to do. He wants to make you feel feeble and unnecessary. But every person in the body of Christ is necessary. And it's the small things that you do. Keep that in mind. It's not the huge things. It's the small things that you do that very often impact people. There's an interesting story in the book of Acts. It's found in chapter 9, verses 36 through 41. And there it simply says, "There was a believer in Joppa named Tabitha, which in Greek is Dorcas. She was always doing kind things for others, helping the poor. About this time, she became ill and died. Her friends prepared her for burial, laid her in an upstairs room. But they had heard that Peter was nearby at Lydda, so they sent two men to beg him, 'Please come as soon as possible.' So Peter returned with them, and as soon as he arrived, they took him to the upstairs room. The room was filled with widows who were weeping, now listen, and showing him the coats and other garments Dorcas had made for them." The thing that she did is she would actually just make garments for him. That's no big deal, is it? But look at how it touched these people. They said, "Look what she did for us. These things matter." The small things, keep that in mind. It's not the huge things. It's the small things. Unnoticed by some, noticed by God. And it changes lives. And these people came and spoke to John and said, "We want you to know concerning Gaius what a great man he is." They said that he was walking in the truth, and that caused great joy. Now, when he says in verse 4, "I have no greater joy than to hear that my children walk in truth," his Christian faith was not simply intellectual, it was practical. And truth that was in him was revealed by the things that he did. This is someone who showed compassion. This is someone who showed love to someone who was in need. And that, to me, is a tremendous sign of spiritual maturity. He says in verse 5, "Beloved, you do faithfully whatever you do for the brethren and for strangers who have borne witness of your love before the church. If you send them forward on their journey in a manner worthy of God, you will do well. Because they went forth for his name's sake, taking nothing from the Gentiles, we therefore ought to receive such that we may become fellow workers for the truth." And so the things that he was doing was shown through his hospitality and his support of ministers who had visited the church. Hospitality in the ancient world was looked at as a sacred duty. It remains so even to this day. During this time, they had what are called inns, but they were generally dirty. They were flea infested. Innkeepers were on the lowest rung of society at that time. They charged people for that which should have been given freely. That was the mindset of that age. Hospitality should have been something done generously and freely. There was a Greek philosopher by the name of Plato, and he called innkeepers pirates. He said, they hold guests for ransom before they're allowed to escape. And so he didn't have a good word for innkeepers. You see, in the ancient world, they had what was a system called a system of guest friendships. So families would open up their homes to family members from other countries. And all the traveling family member needed was an identification, and that way they would be sheltered. And so because that was true in the heathen world, they were known for generosity and for caring for traveling strangers, the question should be, should not the church be more so? Well, in 1 Peter 4, 9, it says, offer hospitality to one another without complaining, without grumbling. You know, it's Christmas, Grandma's here, but when's she going to go? You know, without complaining. Notice what he says in verse 6 concerning the support of ministers. He says, if you send them forward on their journey in a manner worthy of God, you do well. The church's responsibility towards genuine ministers, care for them generously, shelter them, feed them, encourage them, even provide funds for traveling. But you do so for those who are worthy, those who are doing the work of ministry. He says in verse 7, they went forth for his name's sake. These are those who went forth in the name of the Lord for the sake of God. That's what they did. They went everywhere for Christ's sake. Everywhere for Christ's sake. So there was this sports writer, used to write for the LA Times, I believe. He was in Africa, and he was driving his car on a dirt road and some path doing sightseeing years ago now. And the car in front of him stopped. And when the car stopped, that car started backing up, and the sports writer stops because the car is getting close to him and then makes a wide turn in order to make a turn and come back. So the guy unrolls his window and yells at him and says this. This is a quote. He says, "Where are you going, for Christ's sake?" And Billy Graham was the driver of the other car. And Billy Graham stuck his head out of the window and he says, "I go everywhere for Christ's sake." And that's basically what's being said here. They went forth for his name's sake. They went out preaching in the name of Jesus Christ. Again, remember that false teachers go out on their own authority for their own profit. But these missionaries went for the name of Jesus Christ. And so notice how he says in verse 7, taking nothing of the Gentiles. They were missionaries, not mercenaries. The church has an obligation of supporting the spread of the gospel, and the world doesn't have that obligation. And so we, as the body of Christ, care for our own. He says in verse 8, "We therefore ought to receive such that we may become fellow workers for the truth." This is interesting. These are people who are worthy of support. They should be properly cared for, he's saying. In our regular purchasing habits, we need to remember that we support many companies that are opposed to our values. Many. And you know, any if I mention any automaker, any brand of automobile in here, the cars that I've seen in the parking lot, like your Bentleys and your Rolls Royces, you know, that I see out there, there's so many of them. And Kias. If you went and looked into the charitable organizations they support, you know, when you buy their car, many times they're giving to organizations that you would never give your money to. You wouldn't. If these organizations were to contact you for a donation, you'd say, "No, I'm sorry, philosophically, I'm opposed to how you use this money." You would do that. And yet, I've done this. I've had people, you know, write me and say, "How about this, and if you that?" And it's, well, the bottom line is, almost every single thing that you buy, if it's a corporation, that corporation is sending a portion of your money into organizations that you do not support. And that's just a bottom line fact. That's what happens. So in our regular purchasing habits, we support many companies we're opposed to concerning our values. So the point is, we should care for ministers and their ministries because they have eternal impact. And that's the reason you give in that way. You know, we've had people here in our fellowship will go into our bookstore and get a lot of information about a book that they want to buy. And when they get all that information, they go and they purchase it online. And so they're going to save a dollar. And they don't realize that if you bought the book here, that money goes into ministry. But when you go online and you buy through Amazon or whatever, your money's going into a corporation that is not doing ministry to save a dollar. Rather than to give that dollar, I'd like you to think about that whenever you purchase, because it's just wise to do that. Because in a lot of ways, we support those who are opposed to everything we really believe in. Now, what's interesting also, I should point this out, is when he says in verse 8, that we may become fellow workers for the truth. Fellow workers. In supporting them, you are partaking in the work and the fruit as well as the rewards of the work that they're performing. When I prepared this study, I wasn't thinking of Jess and Nesty and the work in the Philippines. I wasn't thinking of it. But the gifts and offerings that go towards their support and the work that they're performing, the reward from the support that we have, they're getting a reward for performing those works. We get a support. We get a reward also for our support of that work. And what's really interesting, Paul said it this way in Philippians 4:17 is that he said, not that I'm looking for a gift, but I'm looking for what may be credited to your account. In the gifts that you give, and maybe you don't know this, in the gifts that you give to the Lord, when that gift is put into ministry, when you see people come forward at invitations, when you hear stories of, you know, hundreds of boxes of toys taken to Mexico, or charitable work that was done at one of the soup kitchens around here, or there's so many things our church does. I've been saying to my people, I ought to be saying more about the things that you guys do. Your gifts, when you give your gifts, they have eternal dividends, eternal reward. And ultimately, one day, you'll receive that reward because you supported the work that God was performing. And that's what Paul's saying. And that's what John said. Now notice, I better hurry up. I only have a few minutes. And I'm at verse 9 already. I'm just rushing through, aren't I? He says, I wrote to the church, but Diotrephes, who loves to have the preeminence among them, does not receive us. Therefore, if I come, I will call to mind his deeds, which he does, prating against us with malicious words. Not content with that, he himself does not receive the brethren and forbids those who wish to, putting them out of the church. Then he says, beloved, do not imitate what is evil, but what is good. He who does good is of God, but he who does evil has not seen God. Diotrephes. Diotrephes did not want any teaching in the church except his own. He was a tyrant. He couldn't stand for his influence to be challenged, and he wanted to be the most important. I should say this as a confession. When our fellowship was younger, I was afraid to bring in better speakers because I knew, in my heart I thought, oh, they're going to prefer that guy over my teaching. And I was jealous. There I said it. But that's true. That's true. People can be fickle. I have had people say, when are you going to leave again? You always bring such good speakers. No, I'm trying. I find that funny. And I'm blessed because I want them to be blessed by the speakers, of course. But see, at the beginning, I wasn't quite like that at all because I was jealous. And the Lord said a long time ago, no, the best thing you can do is encourage them to have a great meal. Bring the best teachers you can bring so they can be the best fed sheep. And that's really what shepherds are supposed to do. But when you have a jealousy about authority and you want to be the preeminent one, then you're not going to allow anybody in if they in any way are going to challenge who you think yourself to be. So he could not stand for his influence to be challenged because he wanted to be the best. So what does he do? Well, notice verse 10. He openly rejects the authority of John. Now, the word prating, did you use that word today? That's not a word we use, right? He said prating against John with malicious words. When the word prating speaks concerning uttering nonsense, he was bringing idle accusations, making up empty charges. Whenever anybody makes up charges like Diotrephes was, there's an intent there to steal the heart of people away from somebody else and bring that heart to themselves. And so he was making malicious charges against John, because he didn't want anybody to respect John the elder's authority. And so he put himself against John and said malicious things about him. And he wanted to undermine John by these accusations. A second thing he did is he would not receive the brethren. Well, by not receiving them, that was a way of showing his authority. So he would not show hospitality, and he would not recognize these emissaries of the kingdom. A third thing he did is he put them out of the church. He kicked them out. And what he did is he refused to comply to those things that were right, and he ended up just bullying people. And that's why He says in verse 11, do not imitate what is evil, but what is good. He who does good is from God, but he who does evil has not seen God. In other words, you need a better example. You need to follow the Lord, and you need to follow John's example. You see, a good example is verse 12, Demetrius. Demetrius has a good testimony from all and from the truth itself. We also bear witness, and you know that our testimony is true. So this is a man who is blameless, and he's saying the facts speak for themselves. Just look and see the difference between Diotrephes and Demetrius, and you'll see the work of God in one man's life and the work of the flesh in the other. And finally, he said, I had many things to write, but I do not wish to write to you with pen and ink. I hope to see you shortly. We shall speak face to face. Peace to you. Our friends greet you. Greet the friends by name. A couple of closing thoughts. Here's something for you. Take me just 1 minute. Christianity, this can be threatening, so I'll say it hopefully in a way that makes sense. Christianity is relational. Christianity is a philosophy of life that is lived out in relationship with other human beings. There are reasons why we'll ask you to hold one another's hands. I know some of you feel uncomfortable with that. I respect that. I really do. And if you don't, that's between you and the Lord, you ogre. No, that's... We do have hand cleaner, by the way. Before you come in, you can clean your hands up nice and dainty if you'd like. But I do understand that, and please never feel like you're being forced to do something. If you don't feel comfortable with that, you're not a bad person. If you don't, that's okay. You need to understand two things. One is, when I got saved, I came from an environment where putting arms around each other, singing to the music and swaying, that's what we did. That's what we did. And when we would gather together for prayer, we would actually sit on carpets. We were hippies. We would sit on carpets and we would hold one another's hand. That's what I was brought into. See, that's my background. So I have never really thought how uncomfortable you may be. Forgive me for not thinking that way. I just don't. Because I said, well, I had to get used to it. And I did. I've told you this is a true story, that when we would hold hands when I first got saved and a man would hold my hand, I was uncomfortable. That's the bottom line. You know, we could. My dad didn't say, I love you. My dad didn't show affection. My dad didn't even show outward affection to my mom in front of us. That was how I was raised. I think a lot of you may have had similar to me. That's how I was raised. No affection. No, my dad, to show me affection, would hit me in the back of the head. That's a fact. I'd walk by and he'd hit me. And my mom, I said, why is Dad hit me? And my mom told me as a little boy, because he loves you. That's the truth. That's the truth. And I don't say that, it's just true. So I was raised in a very you don't show affection environment. My mom was affectionate, but my dad wasn't. And so men don't show affection. Women do. That's how I was raised. Now I'm with these hippie freaks who are Jesus freaks, and we're sitting on carpeting, and they want me to hold that guy's hand. And it just does not make sense. But I would do it because I'm a new creation in Christ Jesus. Old things are passed away. I can get over this. But I would squeeze their hands real tight just so they didn't get any ideas. That's true. That's true. Christianity is relational. It's love. We learn to love one another. Now, if you aren't comfortable, God bless you. I'm very serious when I say, just smile at the person next to you. Give them your elbow, whatever. But always remember that. Sometimes there are people in this room who have not had any other human being touch them until tonight. Until tonight. They live alone. They don't work in an environment that's affectionate. They come to church and they feel the same way here as they do on the job. To me, I had a friend named George who brought me to help to bring me to faith in Christ. And George is the guy who helped me. He would grab me and hug me and hold me. And I'm telling you, I would stiffen up. And it was just because I'm not used to this, you know. You know, man, I love you, brother. And he put his face on my face. I have a very dear friend. His name is Scotty. He won't mind me saying this to you. He cuts my hair. I've known him for 30 plus years. And Scotty will grab me by the face sometimes just to kiss me. He's a hairdresser in his shop kissing me. And I'm fine with that because I love him too. And every time he cuts my hair, when I walk out, he grabs me and he holds me. And he'll tell me the same thing, always. I love you, Pastor. You're not just my pastor, you're my friend. And I say, you're right, Scotty. Give me a kiss. Now, men, I'm not asking you to do that, and don't worry. We're not going to do that in men's small groups. Let's love one another. Love is practical and it is expressive. And finally, he says this, and I'll close this. He says in verse 14, I hope to see you shortly. We shall speak face to face. Peace to you. Our friends greet you. Greet the friends by name. I'm looking forward to seeing you. I will minister to you. We'll get together. And oh, by the way, when I get there, I will deal with Diotrephes. I will deal with him. And Diotrephes, I have no doubt in my mind that John came, brought the word to him, restored him, and taught him some things about what it means to be a believer in Jesus Christ. That's what elders do.